Good evening. This is George Lees on episode 2 about Archie Primrose. Roseberry lived for a time in Naples. Lovely little house he had. Yeah, used for several centuries after, or a century and a bit, after he had left Naples, yeah, and after both he and his plump Hannah Rothschild wife had died relatively young and very dispirited about what they had done in their lives. Yeah, despite their career ambitions all being fulfilled, that's Archie Primrose Roseberry, yeah, who was the British Prime Minister for a year and a tiny bit in the lead up to the massive wars in sub-Saharan Africa all along the Nile to secure the British ownership of those massive rivers 6,000 miles from the UK. And I've told you now that the place that is Naples, where the Christian Bible was written, which is what I was holding in front of my face on the seat there, is the massive epicentre for biblical fraud, because that is where the Pisos lived in the Villa Papyri. And I'll be taking you back to that, and I'll be showing you where the Rothschild owned central bank was established there. That's the news that we released, that the central bank in Italy is also in Naples. Right then, so the other central bank that we revealed as the fifth in the Five Arrows project is the one in Austria. And because I love patriotism and I love honesty, this is still one of my favourite movies, despite the massive jokes that they use in it. Those are the jokes that the Von Trapp family singers, yeah, are actually led by the man Detweiler, and Detweiler is now the leading producer of drones in our combative world. Yeah, you don't need to declare war on anybody to murder a leader in a distant continent. The Americans have proven that with the Detweiler Macdonald drone system, yeah, to kill people on distant continents without even any vague adherence to the Geneva Conventions. And because the Genevan things are Swiss, it's all kind of twisted anyway. Right then, but I love the music. And this man never gets an Oscar, yeah, despite all of the innocent films that he makes. But he's also in the religious fraud films about the Thorn Birds, which is a joke about bishops and cardinals shagging lovely blondes in Australasia on the beach. Yeah, only the Australasians could get away with that. And in that respect, the last song that you just heard, that was the introduction, which is the Italian national anthem, is very jingoistic. And that the Italian, you remember the Italians changed sides in World War II? Yeah, and Mussolini in the end was strung up, believe that if you like. Yeah, it's amazing how the fascism just keeps rolling on and on and on. And the Scipio that they mention in the lyrics of the national anthem is Skippy the bush kangaroo joke, yeah, because that is the general that brutalized Carthage, yeah, and flattened it, and that becomes the Skippy the bush kangaroo joke in Australasia. Okay, this one's lovely.
Unanimous. You, Captain.
So that is Mr. Detweiler. Detweiler McDonald's. Do you get it? Detweiler is the head of the Von Trapp family singers, and I have not found the evidence for this yet, but there is a man called Van Tripp, and it's the Van Tripp
hotel empire, but he is a winner in the Formula One racing sector, and I believe that will be the joke about this one before they launched Detweiler McDonald's as another brutal joke against the peace-loving nations. Almost all of them are out with the G20. The G20 are brutal bastards for all of human existence. And there's a blonde bimbo who's portrayed as evil in the movie. She's probably innocent, but I can't remember what her name was, because the woman that is the heroine in this, that plays Mary Poppins, is the Virgin fucking Mary joke again. Okay, that's Maria. Yeah. And what are we going to do about her? Right then. So, but the music is lovely, and this guy, apart from the Thornbirds thing, always plays the innocent. And his name is George.
I don't understand.
Please.
Georg. Oh, shoot. Georg. And he's got a guitar like Elvis.
Told
me a long time ago you were quite good. Well, that was a very, very, very long time ago. I remember, Father. Play something now. Father? Yeah. So his fatherland is actually Austria, and that is the joke about the Viennese central bank.
Bring it down, my
humble. Also in the Rothschilds' power base. Another patriot. I'm kind of sickened by Scotland's history now. I cannot find anybody in it that is inspiring at all. The modern day characters are even more sinister than the historic villains. And the only inspiration I can find is by playing the sickly music about the Braveheart movie, which is all about treason, with the actor being a leading part of the Zionist joke. Yeah, and when they lift the kilts and trivialise the whole thing, it is absolutely disgusting. Yeah, none of Scotland is owned by anybody in Scotland. Yeah, and all of what the politicians have done makes that really, really serious. They have now about three or four, maybe even five tiers of politics, five or six tiers of sovereign debt, and all of it is pathetic. None of them have the will or the courage to stand up and tell the truth about what's happened to our whole world. Okay, which is why I was particularly saddened to see that this guy never wins an Oscar for anything that he does. But when I see the Thornbirds movie and you see the villainy in that, which is an accurate reflection about Christianity, because it is just a means to deceive the minds of the masses everywhere. Right then. So, something a little bit more upbeat. And let's go into London. And elite London. How's about that? A good night out in elite London. With a war protester. And a blonde in the lead role. Yeah, and she's famous in wartime for inspirational songs about the White Cliffs. Yeah, near where the man at Hastings got the arrow in the eye, coming out of the five flies and the five arrows flying out of Frankfurt right into the eye of the Britannic king.
Covering the grey is just the beginning. It's time for younger looking hair. Age Defy Hair Color Collection from Nice and Easy. A sister.
Oh. Vera Lynne. Lynne is a waterfall, is a fall line. And the Dover cliffs are falling into the ocean, willy-nilly, like the Scarborough cliffs.
The night we met, there was magic abroad in the air. There were angels dying at the Ritz, and the nightingale sang in Berkely Square. I may be right, I may be wrong, but I'm perfectly willing to swear that when you turned and smiled at me, a nightingale sang in Berkeley Square.
So, that's close to where the elite people are, yeah, in the inner circle. That is the Bloomsbury set in London. That is the Wittgensteins. That is the people that run the classics sector in Oxbridge. Okay, many of them end up unhinged, because their mission in life is so evil, it's unbelievable. But God understands it all. Okay, so let's take you now, because that is one of the places, Berkeley Square, where Archie Primrose Roseberry, the Prime Minister of Britain, in the brutalisation of the Nile Valley, 6,000 miles from Britain, yeah, and he openly declares that he is against socialism, which is why he kills working men all over the globe, yeah, and why he died in a depressed state like Wittgenstein and the Bloomsbury set. And that's where the Freuds came from originally, okay, and it is massive, and they launch all of the psychedelic drug craze, and all of that is followed up with the pop musicians launching the psychedelic drug festivals and the use of tents and caravans and pilgrimages to take the people from their homes and into this deviant sector. Right then, so Archie Primrose, we got to the fact that Disraeli was a mate of his in the political sector, often met with Roseberry in the 1870s to try to recruit him for his party, but this proved futile. Disraeli's major rival, William Gladstone, Ewart Gladstone, also pursued Roseberry with considerable success. So that's where we left off, and it's on the story of Primrose, and we've already declared in brief that he and his Hannah Rothschild wife, our maiden name, she also lived with him in that elite villa in Naples, where the Bible fraud is written. So this is the connection between the massive globalized land grabs and the religious fraud that drives along the more modern, you know, you don't really need an excuse to brutalize a pagan native anywhere across the world. You just do that because you've got the power base. But nowadays, when we're not allowed to smack our kids, you've got to justify things by religious hatred and all that the white man did, yeah, in Naples and in Rome, was to create the power base that is the Jesus Christ myth. Yeah, And then suddenly, in 610, they launch the Islamic myths, exactly the same characters in the story, and that takes you back into the even older Egyptian myths. They just keep using it, and they keep brutalizing the world without any comeback at them as war criminals. Right then, let's get down so we can look at most of the tabs in this. Roseberry served as Foreign Secretary in Gladstone's brief Third Ministry, 1886. Remember, the cartoon thing was in 1888, and that is three continuing replays. Yeah, that probably is three continents, and they think it's really funny that we can take over the whole of Asia, and all of it, they're using the same methods, and Australasia is a goner too. That's the Scipio joke. Right then, Roseberry's second period as Foreign Secretary, 1892 to 1894, predominantly involved quarrels with France over Uganda, thousands of miles from home too. To quote his hero Napoleon, who's a friend of Louis XIV and is a super elite in his own right, look at Napoleon's history, look at Le Normand, the body double who played Napoleon and who was actually one of the people that was, he was a very close relative to Louis XIV. Roseberry, and he killed 600,000 ordinary people in that campaign, which is a pretend revolution. Yeah, and the Rothschilds funded both sides, and we've now given you music from all of the central banking terrains. You've heard the Edelweiss song from Austria, from the Venice region, okay? Oh, sorry, Vienna, and you've heard the Italian national anthem about never being conquered. It's a total lie. Yet even the scams within it, the federations of scamming groups like the Goths and Visigoths, who are capable locally in the provinces, they're keeping control over the effete governors that Rome sends out there, and that becomes the FIFA joke. I'm getting a bit repetitive, but I think you understand it, and the newspapers in Britain certainly do. It's all over the papers all of the time. Next week we start the Rugby World Cup facade again. Roseberry helped Gladstone's second Home Rule Bill. That's the World War One 1916 issues, the Bloody Sunday issues. And if I've got time, I'll play you the zombie record. Yeah, that's about the guns and the bombs in Belfast and the Christianity fraud all tied up into one massive sectarian bloodbath. Okay? Right then. So, he became Prime Minister when Gladstone retired in 1894. Much to the disgust of Sir William Harcourt, those are the solicitors and legal firms in New Zealand that moved us, the Harcourts, when we left Dunedin and we came back to the massive snowstorms in Britain in 2009 when we touched down at Heathrow and spent the first few months of our return from exile in my brother-in-law's cottage near, right next door to Chipping Norton, where the government and the Freuds and all of the frauds of the phone hacking and the media scandals are run from, the place that Ronnie Barker and the two Ronnies used to live in. Got an antique shop there, dead in the grave, and his wife is Lady Barker now. Okay, and Roseberry's selection was largely because Queen Victoria, and this is the myth, that Queen Victoria, as a mindless member of the royals, who's not even allowed to have legitimate marriages, let alone legitimate children, because she's in a bigamous marriage to the German Prince Albert, yeah? And her first marriage is the loving one, and she keeps writing to, until they kill him, the man that was her true lover, and who sired the only legitimate child that she had on the Isle of Wight, and that was Marcus Manuel, yeah? Played by Peter Sellers in the Being There film. Okay, and I can show you some of Greg Hallett's writings on what happens to those families and how the role of visitors to the Roseberry Villa in Naples, yeah, not the Pufdas, but actually the monarchs from the illegitimate British royals. I'll tell you that story really soon when we get to the bottom of this entry on Roseberry himself. Okay, so this is the genocides. He took a strongly pro-Armenian and anti-Turkish policy, but was, so he and Queen Victoria are totally powerless. The Rothschilds run the show because they're the money lenders and they make the demands, and the Balfours are their CICs, yeah, commanders in chief. They're the people that see through the deals on Palestine, the Russian steppe oil wealth, and all of the negotiations are overseen by Churchill the bastard. Yeah? And he becomes one of the most legitimate members of the royal bloodlines, because he's about a fifth of a royal by the time they get beyond Queen Victoria, and they need to sire an heir to the man who makes the stammering speech at the beginning of World War II, and he's an imbecile with an IQ of 70. Okay, Roseberry's government was largely unsuccessful. It's all quite boring about him. He was unable to stop the massacres of the Armenians that Churchill saw through. Okay, yeah, and we've told you all about that. We've told you about Gallipoli and Churchill being shamed for all of that. But nevertheless, he's back in power for the start of World War II. The steppes, Churchill, Balfour, Rothsital, talking of oil, Pumpherston is interesting. That's the Almond River Valley, leading from the Lothian coast, and the Balfour controlled and the Robert Louis Stevenson controlled big posh houses there. Yeah, and when you see the Bannerman connections from Glasgow and the links to Kelvinside and Henry Campbell and those nascent power brokers that are also genocidal out of the West Coast, yeah, it is really sickening. And all of them, Glasgow and some of the either the Bannermans or the Campbells, the brothers of the prime ministerial candidates, are actually MPs representing the universities of Glasgow and the University of Aberdeen. Okay, there's Bannerman. So there's a Bannerman Burke, a law firm in Galashiels and in Hoyk in the Borders, and now you see the importance of the law. He was the first Lord of the Treasury to be officially called Prime Minister, the term only coming into difficult some 5 days after he took office. Yeah, so this is the Chancellor, the head of the Treasury, and they begin to call him the Prime Minister for the first time in I don't know when he was inaugurated, 1905 to 1908. Okay, we're getting closer to World War One now. Khartoum's already a goner. Yeah, all of the Zulu massacres have occurred thousands of miles from home, with all of the troops sent out there, very, very few of them return. Roseberry rapidly lost interest in running the government in the last year of his premiership. He only had 1 year. He was increasingly haggard. He suffered insomnia due to the continual dissension of his cabinet. On 22nd June, he and his ministers tendered their resignations to the Queen, who invited the Unionist leader, Lord Salisbury, to form a government. The following month, the Unionists won a crushing victory in the 1895 general election and held power for 10 years up to 1905, and Arthur Balfour from Kelso and the Scottish Borders came into power. Roseberry remained the Liberal leader for another year, then permanently retired
from the politics. Okay, so there's the little cartoons of the time. That's Vanity Fair, and that's Roseberry with his hand on his hip. Always the questions about his sexuality, so he can be displaced really easily by the power brokers. And Winston Churchill, although he's the closest thing to a legitimate royal with only a fifth of royal blood in him, he's able only to sire the royal children by artificial insemination. And the American president Bill Clinton is born into the world the same way. It's a tragedy. He broke with the mainstream of the Liberal Party by supporting the Boer War and opposing Home Rule in Ireland. Yet he wants them to be slaves to the British elites and to send them to their deaths in conflicts thousands of miles from home. Writing, including biographies of Lord Chatham, Pitt the Younger, Napoleon, and Lord Randolph Churchill. He admires Napoleon, but he hates socialism. Isn't that an enigma? Okay, Liberal governments of Campbell Bannerman and Asquith, yeah, all of them. I've never heard of the Campbell Bannermans until I read these articles. Right then. Yeah. John Buchan, yeah, that's Lord Tweedsmuir, the Tweedsmuirs that write the 39 steps joke and become the Governor General of Canada. And that is the Buchans that launched two generations of football players at Manchester United out of Aberdeen, where the Bannerman or the Burke or the Campbell was the MP brother of the other Bannerman that became the Prime Minister and the opposition to the man, the sad bastard that we're profiling here, crushed by bodily weaknesses and sunk in sad and silent meditations. Okay? And he's almost in the last years of his life in politics, almost blind. Okay? Roseberry died at the Durdens, Epsom, Surrey on 21st May 1929 to the accompaniment, as he had requested, of a gramophone recording of the Eton boating song. Yeah? The Eton College that were all of the three prime ministers in his ruthless era came from. Yeah, and at the end of his life he's still laughing at the joke. And his wife dies at 39 from a horrible illness involving kidney stones, horribly painful. Survived by three of his four children, he was buried in the small church at Dalmenny. This is why Tony Blair's in the news. His estate was probated at £1,500,000, equivalent of 63 million now, and that he was thus the richest Prime Minister ever, followed by Salisbury, then by Palmerston. Yeah, and Lord Sainsbury has billions. Yeah, and he doesn't even make it to Prime Minister, which is why Blair is under scrutiny now and he's looking ever so old. And he deserves everything he gets from God, who has all of the evidence tucked away. So here's Fat Hannah, his wife, and you can see the smoking volcano. That is Naples, the Bay of Naples, and their home is right opposite it. So at the age of 31, Roseberry married 27-year-old Hannah de Rothschild, 1851 to 1890, only child and sole heiress of the Jewish banker Mayor Amschel de Rothschild and the wealthiest British heiress of their day, of her day. Okay, so that's one of his three ambitions, was to marry an heiress, to become the Prime Minister, and to win the Derby at Epsom. Okay, he's got all of that, and the Bright's disease is coming at her, and he's going to die in a depressed state because he's let his nation down. Following his wife's death, yet with the Bright's disease issues, it was speculated that Roseberry intended to marry the widowed Princess Helena, Duchess of Albany, widow of Prince Leopold, Duke of Albany, fourth son of Queen Victoria. It was also speculated that Roseberry was bisexual. Here it comes.
Yeah, Hitler has only got one ball. Everybody gets demonised beyond their period in power. Yeah, like Cyril Smith and all of those people. Jimmy Savile. Yeah, he gets to be a knight in the last year of Mrs. Thatcher's reign. As soon as he's croaked, they demonise them and they let the criminals, now new to the cabinet, carry on with it. David Cameron is trying to resist that because he now is God-fearing. Like Oscar Wilde, the poofter, he was hounded by John Douglas. Now, this is the evidence for his bisexuality, and he's keeping his little hand up on his hip. Yeah, there it is. Yeah, the hand in the pockets is a different gesture. That's the hand on the wallet gesture. Okay, so is he bisexual? Can we get the whole world wondering about him and why the policies are so effete? Like Oscar Wilde, he was hounded by John Douglas, 9th Marquess of Queensberry. Yeah, that is the boxing rules, man, for his association with Francis Douglas, Viscount Drumlandrig, one of the Queensberry sons, who was his private secretary. So if you've got the poofed-up posture in all of the photos and the paintings that they can get, but he gets to play with his own children, which is fairly decent compared to modern-day scams. And even Obama and all of the visitors and all of the elites in the inner circle get to adopt people every time they go to sub-Saharan Africa. There you are, there's the hand on the hip. Yeah. And there's the famous tiara. Yeah, that's the Aryan joke with the Christian cross wound into it. By his wife Hannah de Rothschild, Roseberry had 4 children with whom he loved to play, according to Margaret Asquith, 2 sons and 2 daughters. Okay? Albert Edward Harry Mayer Archibald Primrose, 6th Earl of Roseberry, January 1882 to 1974, known as Harry, eldest son and heir, who served as Scottish Secretary in 1945 when everything was all over with and the cash was in Geneva already. Yet, using the same route that the Von Trapps went across the mountains and that they joked at in the Great Escape movie. Yet, the actor in that movie also died young because of his portrayal of how the profiteering in the war actually works and how easy it is to escape amongst your friends, like the Hogan's Heroes jokes. All of those are made right up into the 1980s, and the Hogan is the Indian tent, and that is a joke about the genocide of the 500 nations in America. He married Lady Victoria Staniel. Oh, this is the children. Neil James Archibald, killed in action in Palestine. Okay, died in 1917. Yet that's the world war that is totally needless, but for these elites and their ambition always to fund and profit from both sides in every conflict. Okay, Sybil Myra Caroline Primrose. I've got my hand on my hip. I'm going to stop that. Okay, who married, this is the daughters, General Sir Charles Grant, fairly anonymous, okay, 1877 to 1950, and then you get this one. This is the one that marries the Duke of Roxburgh, Bobo. Margaret Etten Hannah Primrose, known as Peggy, who in 1899 married Robert Crewe Milnes, first Marquess of Crewe. Such was her father's popularity that London came to a standstill for the wedding. Okay, do you remember those stories? We went to Burke's Peerage and we found the woman, yep, that spent all of her time trying to get the electricity and things turned on in the castle. Yeah, and her husband was trying to get rid of her, and I don't know whether or not that was because she could not give him children, but in the end he married the McConnell bloodline, I believe. Yeah, which takes us into Monaco and into the families that are linked to McConnell. And that's a huge name. Even if you're a freedom fighter, that's the McConnell people that pretend that there is a God and that Jesus Christ is real, because they cite the religious texts and they talk to the pastor in the chamber, the antechamber, and they've got the Freemasonic pinnies hanging round the walls. It's absolutely twisted. 600,000 followers, all of them activists, and looking to secure the system that they've already profited from. Right then, and then you've got, he's in league with the Hawkins. His mate in the chat room is a Hawkins, and that's the Hawkeye joke, and that is the Puttnam Hawk joke, and the Black Hawk Down jokes. All of it is a massive fraud. And when you look at the image of Field McConnell, and you look at the man that was involved in the Iranian issues, he's a dead ringer for that person that was in the US Air Force. I forget what the name of him is, and he's involved in the Latin American land grabs as well. A massive name in American politics at the time. As a result, he may not be the same man, God is capable of doing that. As a result of his marriage to Hannah de Rothschild, Roseberry acquired, this is his grabs, and the properties that he inherits. So he gets Mentmore. We used to live in the region, it's massive. And he gets the studs nearby and in Leighton Buzzard. And in Leighton Buzzard, you've got the places that the Duke of Bedford lives in, and that is the Woburn Golf Course, and all of the jokes with the pythons and the whales in the zoo run by the Duke of Bedford. My wife used to work for him in a British Standards, a British Standards company, and that was the only work she did, before we started to have our children. And all of the things that I owned then were entirely mine before I met her. That's under threat now, and this is how the whole world fails to work. Mayor and which had been built, this is the massive Mentmore Towers at Crafton, Buckinghamshire, called Crafton Stud. The horses are built into every one of the stories. And this is why this man was forced out of public school, because he's got a horse and he wins the Derby, and that's him got all three. So I thought that it was a joke about the saddle, but if they're trying to prove that he's a homosexual or he's not a very potent masculine person, do you see the lad-ass joke, which is the name of the horse that he had at public school? Hand on the hip. All sorts of national gossip about him, where the Rothschilds that own the world are creating all of the bloodlines that are ever so fragile, and that's why all of the royals get syphilis. That's the blue blood syndrome. Okay, lad-ass, do you get it? Poof, chosen Hannah, so Hannah can sleep around into crew and into the Italian elites like Mussolini and Mrs. Simpson. I explained how Mussolini's son caused all of her infertility reasons on her global tour, with the abdicated king. Fascists all. And she lives in the region where the massive civil war and the battles were held at Gettysburg. Right then, so I think we've done enough on him. Let's get to the bit about where they had the residence overlooking the Bay of Naples. Oh no, this is important, because it's a piss take at Scotland's expense. Okay, Roseberry became the first president of London Scottish Rugby Football Club in 1878. That's a massive prop for the game in Scotland, because you've got all sorts of folk that live in the region with Scottish accents, and they love to play for something that seems patriotic to them. So Mike Biggar was their captain, and Mike Biggar's dad was in Colditz, and Mike Biggar had a very, very serious accident and had to have his legs amputated, which leads me to believe that it probably was not an accident at all. And he lives on the Tweed Valley, right next to Merton, where the donkeys do the energy generation, right opposite the Duchess of Sutherland, who sent the colonists to the colonies. Yeah, that's Colditz, the scam where you're allowed to have your slave called a Batman in attendance, as if he had been fighting by your side in the trench warfare or in the aeroplane that got shot down. It's a total stitch-up, and almost all of those are elites and dukedoms and relatives of dukedoms. Okay? Right then. So, London Scottish is gone, and you know now that Gavin Hastings was playing for London Scottish and is part of that fraud. Yeah, that's the man that missed the kicks right in front of the posts when Scotland played England in the World Cup semi-final at Twickenham, where the murders occur later on in the story. Okay, I could take you to Twickenham now, but let me show you the piss take about the Scottish football. So the Rothschild's colours, as you know, are yellow. Yeah, and the colour for giving in war, or cowardice, is white. Yeah, the white flag, okay, and that is death too. That's the white horse in Revelations. You've got the spider icon on the jersey, and you've got this new away, you know, if they've got a country playing against them with blue jerseys, they have to change their strip, and they've chosen to take the piss colours on 9 occasions. So Roseberry also became, yeah, I've never seen it before, but in 2014 it became official policy, and that's a year after, or 2 years after, Rangers were asset stripped for the second time. Yeah, and they're still in the second division. They've not made it back up into the Premier League yet. Thank you to the people that should be my rivals, because I was a Celtic supporter as a boy. I don't support any of the sports now. They're total frauds and they're total deserters to their nation. And that little guy in the middle from Aberdeen used to think he had a good sense of humour, but he is just a thief too. Gordon Strachan. Okay, so the colour strip change, this occurred 9 times during Roseberry's lifetime. Every number is Freemasonic, most notably for the 1900 British Home Championship match against England, which the Scots won 4-1. Okay, that's a friendly, by the way. These colours will be used for Scotland's away kit in 2014. There they are. A piss take. Yeah, and the man that we're talking about here, who is married to Plump Hannah, was a keen collector of fine books and amassed an excellent library. It was sold on 29th October 2009 at Sotheby's, New Bond Street. Roseberry unveiled the statue of Robert Burns in Dumfries on 6th April 1882. Yeah, so the elite writers, the fraudsters, and the bookshops, and the book burning, and the censorship, and the massive scams in the auction houses. I've told you about that in the past. That's where they have a team of sellers, a team of buyers. When the genuine bidders stop bidding, the team of buyers within the company start putting their hand up, and the price of their stock always rises. Everybody gets their performance-related bonus, and nobody gets to buy anything out of the corrupted system. It's like hyperinflation. Okay, and what you've got here is the Google Maps places. Let's show you where he lived first. This is Dalmenny House. Look at it, it's magnificent. Huge, magnificent. It is fucking crammed. Miss Jean Brodie and the places where she took are elite but effete poofda boyfriends for a good weekend. Yeah, that is the Protestant teacher in the school run by Miss Mackay. Yeah, Miss Mackay is the name of the headmistress at Kelso High School. Yeah, and all of it they think is really, really funny. The janitor was allowed to give the speech the first year my kids came back to Scotland, because the janitor is a dead ringer for Al Pacino in the Devil's Advocate movie, and they think that it is really funny to laugh at issues like that. Yep. And all of what has happened to our society, the disappearance of people on the Lothian coast where Miss Mackay comes from, that is Archbishop O'Brien. It is massive, and the Lothian coast is South Queensferry. That's where JK Rowling lives, and that is where the Almond River goes into the sea, and that is where McHale went missing, and the whole thing is a cover for the Balfours and the Robert Louis Stevensons that went to Monterey and launched globalism from there, and all of the stories get launched into popular culture, and suddenly the hero is the person that writes the fiction and defrauds the world. Okay? And the setting for Lord Sir Dalmenny House is the setting for Lord and Lady Roseberry's political house parties. It's crammed ever so posh. Right then. The house stands in a large wooded park and enjoys views across the Firth of Forth. A public path runs along the shore from Queensferry to the west to Crammond. Christ Almond. Do you get it? In the east, although a passenger ferry across the River Almond that used to connect the path to the village of Crammond has not operated since 2000, there is still a traditional agricultural estate of tenanted farms. Okay, that goes all the way back to Agricola and the Roman Empire, and the Roman Wall just nearby ends in the Firth of Forth, just beyond Falkirk and the Camelot, Camelin concept. Roseberry, Mentmore Towers. So this is his properties. The reason I played Berkely Square is that he had a home in Berkely Square. So he's got Mentmore in Buckinghamshire, huge neo-Renaissance stately home, number 40 Piccadilly in London. Yet massive places in the board game that is Monopoly. A shooting lodge at Carrington in Midlothian. A Georgian villa at Postwick in Norfolk. In 1897, wait for it, he bought Villa Delahant in Posilipo. Do you see the resemblance there to the Hippos with the Piso name in that twice? Yeah? It's massive. It is the interlocking elites that run the world since Herod went from the Middle East and the Holy Lands into the Roman court and into the elite's company, and the need to speak Latin or Greek is absolutely massive if you want to stay in the power base, particularly under the smoking gun that is Vesuvius. Right then, so here's the overlooking the Bay of Naples, currently a residence of the President of the Italian Republic, still known as the Villa Roseberry. Okay, and you've got the Villa PigNatelli's, and those are the Italian central banks opened by the Rothschilds, Calman Rothschild on this occasion. Let's show you that now, or let's just go to the bottom in case we've missed anything. There's the Berkely Square one. So that's the nightingale singing and the war songs that were ever so romantic. Yet the White Cliffs of Dover, all of it drives people to their death, and all of the tears flow, and all of the widows that are left in Britain are part of the Hogan's Heroes jokes and the ooh la la stuff in Paris. The Durdens and the Willow around my heart jokes. The Durdens Epsom, where he died in 1929, as Earl of Roseberry, he was laird of Dalmenny House on the banks of the Firth of Forth. That's the second one on the banks of the Firth of Forth. Okay? Oh no, that's the same one. It's a beautiful one. Okay? And here we've got the second one. Barnbugle, just a little bit further along. You know how on Google Maps you can go to these things, but you cannot drag the little character in and have a look at this now? Yeah? It's still there. It's still marked on the map, but I don't know who lives there. JK Rowling's in one of them, and the Balfours used to be in them, and that is the Robert Louis Stevenson Treasure Islands joke, that they went to the House of Shaws. It's one of these. Okay, so the Earl of Roseberry. I think we've had enough on him. Let's now go to the Villa Roseberry. It's lovely. And the villa that was set up by the Rothschilds is even more lovely, because they're really the owners of the whole world. Right then. So this is Villa Roseberry. And I've explained that to you. I'll just show you the pictures, and we'll find them both on Google Maps. There it is. Quite a discreet little place, yet in a very elite place in Naples, right on the shoreline. And the way things stand, Vesuvius is way over here. Okay, the Villa Papyri is somewhere about here. And we'll see that on Google Maps in a moment. Okay, do you get it? This is the massive place that the religious fraud was written. Yeah, and this is also where the Rothschilds, yeah, in 300 years, they're coming into the story about 1500 years after Christianity was launched, but they then become the world owners, and then they fund the papacy. That's the Callman Rothschild scam and everything that has happened since then. And you remember the man dangling under the bridges of London? Goodness knows whether that's real. Like the Russian diplomat or spy that got injected with the nuclear toxic stuff. All of it keeps the people in fear and keeps the whole of society in chaos. And the role that the papacy plays in genocide and diasporas is massive, and it's totally unforgivable. And I'm still hedging on when I make that video on the Inquisition and the launch of the Christian Church and the genocide of all of the innocent people all across our globe in the places that God planted them. The Villa Roseberry is one of three official residences of the President of the Italian Republic, the other two being in Rome. Okay? Have I highlighted anything? Right then. Now, I'm going to tell you a little shocking story now about the ruthlessness of the illegitimacy of the royals in Britain. Okay? Some guests of Roseberry's during his residency between 1894 to 18... Oh no, sorry, I'm not sure when he was resident here. That's his prime ministerial tenure. But some guests of Roseberry's during his residency include King Edward VII and Oscar Wilde. Right then. Oscar Wilde is a poofda. Yet, like the man that we're describing here, Archie Primrose Roseberry might have been a poofda. There's no way of knowing. They deviate the whole of the historical transcript. And if you click on that link, you find the Greg Hallett truth. But I've got it open, and I've got the name King Edward VII ready to search in Greg Hallett's absolutely insightful story about how illegitimate the bloodlines are. Right then, so Greg Hallett, report number 6, the abdication of a queen. Okay, there's a whole profile there for Edward VII on Wikipedia. That's the crock of lies that we get from the papers run by the Rothschilds and run by the companies that they sponsor. Yeah, that's the Murdoch empire now. The taxi system for getting the secrets is the Tourne and taxis. That's somewhere else on the listings here. And I mentioned that in video number 1. Right then, let's shock you about the people that visited Roseberry in Naples and their role in life to secure the British end of the world ownership issues. And remember, Britain has, by that time, one of the largest empires on the globe, and the sun is reputed never to set on that one. It will set soon if I have my way. Yeah, you'd better sit down before you listen to this bit. This is the British Royals, and in the national anthem for Britain, They say that they're prepared to play knavish tricks to overcome their rivals, and that is murder, familicide. Yeah. Ah, shit. So let's get rid of the musical links now, so we can go a little bit quicker. Ah, right then. So, Edward VII, here he is. This is the eldest child of, well, it's not the eldest child of Queen Victoria, but it's the eldest one she had when the German prince, the Pufta, was her husband. So Prince Albert wore a chain in his penis so he could not have sexual congress with anyone. Okay, they killed him. It was pneumonia. They kept all the windows open in his room, and he died of exposure. Okay, so King Edward the Seventh reign was a flat lie royal, 1901 to 10. Yeah, so he's, I forget, Bertie, I think, and he's in the Disraeli movies that they made with John Brown and Billy Connolly, acting out the roles of the innocent man. The man John Brown actually sired the 11th child. So she had 9 with Nathan Mayer Rothschild and one of his uncles or nephews. And she had 1 with blind King George of Cumbria that they later had killed by one of the Orca Fat royals. He was a really short guy and with a massive belly on him. But this is Bertie, yeah, that's prominent in those movies as the man that wants, is keen to displace his mother and to displace anybody else that gets in his way. Yeah, but what you see he's doing is to get rid of the opposition that are the genuine, or much more genuine people than he, to be the real King of England. Okay, so number 2, Edward the Seventh. Let's see what number 1 is. 1 of 15. So that's what we've got there. 2 of 15 is three. Ah. So the next person to reign after Queen Victoria died on the 22nd of January 1901 was King Edward. So when Queen Victoria died in 1901, King Edward VII took over, who also knew that his elder legitimate half-brother was alive. So King Edward VII's coronation was delayed for 18 months, from the 22nd of January 1901 to the 9th of August 1902. At the same time, King Edward VII got the Secretary of War, Lord Kitchener, yeah, that's the one that used to say, your country needs you, and point at you. Yeah, and he's the one that Churchill had chucked off the edge of the boat, because he's a professional soldier, and he would have stopped the wars before Churchill was able to profit. So at the same time, King Edward VII got the Secretary of War, Lord Kitchener, to alter the mandate of Freemasonry, which was originally about keeping the true monarch on the throne, and he changed it to whatever it is today. Totally fraudulent. Let's see what else they're prepared to do. So the next person to reign, after Queen Victoria died on 22nd January was King Edward VII, who also knew that as his emperor. We've just done that one, so that's 5, 6. Now King Edward VII and his reign from 1901 to 1910 organised the murder of the Portuguese royal family, organised the abdication of the next royal family, organised the murder of his legitimate older half-brother, and then passed instructions. This is the one who visited Naples with the poof. And then passed instructions on to his son, King George V, who reigned from 1910 to 1936, just before the imbecilic, stumbling, mammering king, yet who could not put two words together, made the speech about World War II. And the other guy had defected with Mrs. Simpson to free Paris to party for the whole of the war. Okay, so King George V, who reigned from 1910 to 1936, and this is about Edward VII again, to assassinate the exiled King of Portugal, King Manuel II of Portugal, in Twickenham, in South London. Twickenham is where they picked the Thatcher family to be celebrities in the rugby world. That's Mrs. Thatcher's husband, who's a director at Burma Oil. Okay, so that destroyed the last vestiges or thereabouts. Let's just see what it says. Of the last vestiges of the Portuguese royal family. Now, I've told you the story about Carlos I. That may well be in the same period, but I'm not sure about that. I've made a whole video on that. Look for the murders of Carlos I, George Lees, and Carlos the Jackal, which is the cover they launch into the 20th century to cover all of that crime. And the Portuguese colonies before they started this were massive, and that is all of the jokes of beating up the Portuguese manservant in the Basil Fawlty movies, comedies. And the Basil Fawlty joke, of course, is about the central bank in Basel, where all of the money laundering goes on in peacetime and wartime. Number seven. And then we had from 1936 to 1936, January to December, we had King Edward VIII, who was never crowned. And then we had King George VI. Oh, that's just picking up the name Edward. Yeah, so that's the story about the murderous man who visited the Villa Roseberry. Yeah, and is Queen Victoria's illegitimate child by one of the Rothschilds. Likely to be the goldfish joke, Nathan Mayer. His penis is the organ that sires all of the children in the royal household. Okay, right then. So, we've done the Villa Roseberry. Let's have a look at an even nicer place. This is the Piso joke again. Okay, but it is now the Piso joke with the Rothschilds joining in. Okay, so just along the road from the Villa Roseberry, see Edward VII, the assassin visited with Pufdas from the British inner circle. Yeah, this is now the Villa PigNatelli. Yeah, so Natalie, I think that's something to do with goddesses, and God is the G in the middle, and Pi is the Piso biblical authors. And the life of Pi, and the Pishon, and the name of the Nile, and all of the jokes that I've told you already, right in the heart of Naples. And it's the choice for the Rothschilds to launch one of their five arrows into that city associated with all of the biblical fraud. Okay? The Rothschild banking house, and wait for it, there's a joke in this one. I think I told you in the first video. It's the C.M. de Rothschild Figley Bank, the fig leaf. Yeah, the Adam and Eve, the biblical sins, all of the guilt burdens, and what you've got is these disclosures are made by people that are writing, and some of the people with the same names get actually convicted of anti-Semitism because they make these accurate portrayals of how the Rothschilds own all of the massive financial institutions all around the globe now. Okay, so the PigNatelli is a massive museum in Naples. It used to be the central bank. Okay, and they've got other buildings in the centre of town that were still the central bank and much more functional than that one, which looks like the home of one of the Greek gods, does it not? Okay, right then, so we could go to Google Maps now. There's the yellow journalist, the Bright's disease. I profiled them. Let me show you how important
it is that you get so here's the stories about the new man in the Berwick region and the Tweedsmuir story. Where is that? Tweedmouth. Okay, so we've done the Villa Roseberry, which is the manipulation, the links to the Rothschilds, the links to the high priests of Israel, which are the females married to the Rothschilds. Those are the Cohens, or the Baron Cohens, or the Baron Cohens. Okay, Tweedmouth, this is some of the allies of little Archie, the lowlife, potentially Pufta, but with two male children, two female children, but nobody knows who sired those. Yeah, and part of the art is finding innocent people that can play that breeding role. And that's why they were so desperately sad that the maid that was the Queen Mother, that liked the gin at the GG events and the races, yet she was from the downstairs sector, yet that's why she's called the maid, and her daughter is Queen Elizabeth II. Yet, and her father is the imbecilic king, and that is the King's Speech movie. Right then, so let the Almond Valley will take us into, I believe, the Queen's Ferry region. So let's get back into Scotland and the jokes about Miss Jean Brodie and the elites in Scotland. And let me show you where the House of Shaws is and where all of those shenanigans with the missing child called Mikhail occurred. That might take a wee bit of time to open. And this is the location of Dalmenny House, South Queensferry, and all of the places that we're talking about. And Pumpherston is well up the river, the river that we talked about. The okay, so there's the Forth Bridge, there's Dunfermline, where you've got links to one of the Christian abbeys, cathedrals. Yeah, and there's Dalmenny House, and you've got the other house that is still just, it's one third of a mile to the north of Dalmenny House on the coast. You've got that massive house that the man Archie used as his place. When he was stressed out, he would go there alone, which makes me wonder why he was alone for so much of the time, and where his wife was, and why they had villas in Italy. So his wife could get impregnated. Both of them die depressed and young, and hers is a horrible death. Okay, so I've revised my opinions on her being taken out by the family, because it has all the hallmarks of an act of God. That is if the historians are telling any of the story accurately. Okay, so, and there's, we're up the Almond Valley now, but if we zoom in there, we can see what it looks like. I'll just have to put the camera down. So this is where the Robert Louis Stevenson lives. This is where the Balfours live. This is where the Treasure Islands film is launched. There's a statue to that at Kirstorfin, where they now, the jokers, they have the massive zoo. Everywhere there's a zoo, it's a joke about the Piso Menagerie. And when we visited it with my family, with my intact family group, when I visited my profiteering family that worked for the Church of Scotland, yeah, in league with the healthcare scams in Scotland, and in league with the looking after your own parents in the Edinburgh City Council scams, it is massive. And she used to be a guide leader, and she's had a heart attack. None of them understand it. Her children have had horrible birth issues, and they get pain all the time, and she's married into people that are in the I forget the name of the financial family that is in the Republic of South Africa. Massive. And all of it, they think, can get under people's noses, even in the family group, even although you have
a number of degrees and you're an expert in studying the human condition. Right then. So, Kemp is the name of the family that they're married into. So there's the area we're talking about. There's Dalmenny House. And there on the tip of this little peninsula here, you have the house that I showed you in that earlier picture. And you can take this little character and drag him around. And you can see the falls and the waterfalls in that area. Okay, so if we went to the Almond Valley tab, I reckon we would see those pictures and it would be easier than zooming in. Okay, so let's go and just scan down it, get rid of those. Oh, I wanted to show you the Oxford story before this finishes. Are you getting the picture? The central banking, the issuance of money for every democracy, was started by those five arrows. That's the five Rothschild boys going to those cities: Frankfurt, Paris, London, Vienna, and Naples. Okay? Then all of a sudden, when we get into the American Revolution, the American Wars of Independence, the Canadian calls, all of the Indian gestures, we need to launch 13 fucking central banks all across America. That does not account for Latin America or for Canada. Those are equally fraudulent, and most of them are still sequestered by the British Royals. It's a massive scandal. Okay, so I told you a little bit about this. The Tor Parks and the Hamilton Empires through Stanley Schatz and his damned just above the estuary at Cramond, and runs blood red whenever James the Sixth's controllers blow the Jewish bugle. Okay, so that's about the Roundheads and the Cavaliers and the Springer Spaniels that are still icons for division across the sectarian world. Okay, so the Schatz place way out west up the river valley is where we still have to send all of our Scottish stock from the farming sector for their kosher butchery now. Yeah, all of our slaughterhouses have been shut down by a man with a clipboard. Yeah, because the acts of God afflict the human race in the local regions, and they accuse the humans of negligence on that. So they close them down. Yeah, so when God releases a virus into the population, they have a way now of getting rid of that problem, and it means that we do not have any productivity in our society. Okay, the SFA yellow and pink colours have already shown you that, as recently as 2014, and the Blackburns and the towns up the Almond Valley called Polkhemmet. That's a joke about the Amu Hemnet. That's the Amen joke, and that is the Egyptian pharaohs in the Canaan region where writing was invented. That's the hieroglyphics in the pyramids, the joke about the Egyptian rulers, yeah, and that is the joke about Al-Fayed and all of the things that we bring into the British football sector, all of the demonization of Michael Jackson, the pop singer, and that is just because General Mike Jackson is a killer in Ireland and is a killer in the Balkans and is a killer all over NATO's armies, and he's openly declared that he can earn more than anybody else in private security, and that's on Hansard. It's also on my website. Okay, and what you've got in the Almond Valley is the Marzipandia joke, and marzipan is all yellow. And there's a Dykebro region. Yeah, Greg Dyke is the boss, the Zionist boss at York University, where they also had a massive fire in the Minster. Yeah, and he is now, Greg Dyke, is the leader of the Football Association in England, a media leader. Yeah, so do you see how it works? And Sepp Blatter is now having an affair as an 80-year-old something. He's been in charge of FIFA, which is a federation joke about the Roman Empire and their protection rackets. He's been in charge of them since 1966. Okay, and when you go to the end of the River Almond, you get into a fraudulent shale mine at the place called Pumferston. Yeah, they have difficulty with the linguistics, and they cannot see the words pumper in there. Yeah, it's all just a Freemasonic joke sector. But the tragedy there is that the shale oil and gas project has despoiled the landscape and is highly likely to be a scam about virtual products and selling of coupons. That's the whole of the story about Bill Gamel, who's Rabbi Gamaliel in the Bible and is part of the Christianity fraud too. That's in the Pauline release and the dissemination of all of the false news that is the Christian story. Okay, but that is a Pictish dyke on the Antonine Heartland. Yeah, so the Picts and Romans, yeah, were reputed to have conquered the Romans. Everything that happens in these stories is at the end of one of the Roman roads. Okay, and that is right into the Antonine Heartland. That is the Nerva Antonine movement that fled from Rome after they had killed two emperors, that is Nero and Domitian, and Stanley, the Nile source of the Nile, is all over the upper river here that runs out into the estuary in the Cramon region. Yeah, that is the joke about Miss Jean Brodie. Look at, there's the Miss Jean Brodie issues are excellently covered on YouTube. Yeah, just have a look at how the schoolgirls are taught to be stuffed up and posh, and everything they do